Through a Scottish Prism, the programme that is unapologetically pro-Scottish independence and anti-Westminster rule. Everything we say here is viewed through a Scottish Prism. Brought to you by Barhead Boy.
Hi folks, welcome back to Through a Scottish Prism. Nice to have you back. I hope you've had a lovely Christmas and Boxing Day with your family, and you've not eaten too much, not feeling too rough, not too much to drink. Everything is rosy in the garden for you. It's glad you've come to join us. It's the last show of the year, and first thing, thank you all for watching. And I thought we should finish it with a special guest, and there's no more special guest than the Right Honourable Alexander Salmond, who I'm delighted to welcome back to Through a Scottish Prism.
So, Alec, welcome to Through a Scottish Prism. Nice to have you back. Actually, I've got to thank you because this is our year-end programme, and before I used to do this just by audio because I know I've got a face for radio. But during the election, I did an interview with you, and you were our first video blog. So you're guilty for this show.
It continued, did it?
Yeah, we managed to keep going, yeah. It's been going from strength to strength. But what I would like to do today, if I may chat, just look a wee bit back, and then, because I really want to look forward to what is ahead of you, the party, the independence movement in the coming year. But you can't have a show at the end of the year without looking back a wee bit. And I don't know if you remember, but before ALAPA came into being, the boys and the dog and duck, we sent you a begging letter asking you to come back to the fray, and that would be round about Christmas time last year. So the boys of the Dog and Duck got in touch with you through Jason, actually, Jagget, the Irish blogger. So this time last year...
That was my fault. I didn't realise you were the boys and the dog.
Oh, yeah, we were the boys and the dog and duck, yeah. But that was then. But in February, I mean, did you know that... I mean, you must have been working a wee bit knowing that something was in the pot for February, because it was February, ALAPA appears. How soon into the year did you sort of have your discussions to do that?
Well, far too late, basically, Roddy. But that was dictated by, you know, other events, parliamentary inquiry, and so on and so forth, and the pandemic to some extent. I mean, that obviously slowed up people's meetings, but in a perfect world, and we're not in one, then clearly ARPA would have been formed in good time for the elections, as opposed to against the gunnels of the elections. I mean, there was obviously two significant things. One was being kept out of broadcasting, which was quite disgraceful. I don't mean broadcasting like this. I mean, on the debates, etc. But the second thing was very important, was getting not getting our logo onto the ballot paper. When you get people coming up to you and say, "I couldn't find your party," then you've got some difficulties. But as my dad used to play when he was teaching me, to play golf, you play the ball as it lies, and that was where the ball lied, and that's the way we played it. So in an ideal world, we've been ready much earlier, obviously. But that was the hand we were dealt, so we played it as best we could.
Yeah, but I mean, under the circumstances, I mean, I think we've all beaten ourselves up a bit unjustly, because what was achieved in a short space of time was nothing short of miraculous, in my humble opinion. To have gotten from a zero start to getting all those candidates to getting, all the stuff we did and all the meetings and everything, it was, from a standing start, Alec, it wasn't too bad.
Well, I mean, forming a political party is notoriously difficult, and Mr. Sillers has told me that for the last 30 years or so. And forming it during a pandemic has certainly never been done before. Why is that important? Because then, when you found a political party, the normal ways of stirring up enthusiasm for your cause are, big press conferences, mass meetings, that sort of stuff. All the stuff you couldn't really do, or at least not do as well as you'd want to do it. So that's pretty unprecedented. Conditions we were given, and a lot of the achievements were very substantial. I actually think our biggest achievement was, in a very, very short period of time, introducing a policy debate into many of the things that the SNP have neglected in recent years in terms, and which are going to be essential for the case for independence. Mm-hmm. And I was, what do you do about the European question against the reality that you're no longer in the European Union and would take years to get back in? And therefore, from that, what do you do about the currency question? What about that you do about negotiations in terms of the national debt and other matters? And from these, what do you do about borders? And actually, ALAPA managed in a space of a few weeks to make more progression on these key planks of the independence platform than the SNP have done for some years. And now that doesn't benefit you in an election, because you know there wasn't many folk in the Scottish elections who were saying, well, I'm going to vote for ALAPA because they're for EFTA. But you know, just things don't work like that. Yeah. But over the beach in town, these things are important.
But as I say, I think it was remarkable what happened. But they extended the hand of comradeship, of unity, to the SNP to go for the supermajority, which, of course, I think everybody now knows would have given us the ability to have the ability to close the parliament for wishes, to have a plebiscite election. But it meant taking control. I hate to sound like Tories and Brexit, but it meant we were taking back control of everything. It was taking everything away from Westminster if we had a supermajority. That must have been a big disappointment to you that the SNP chose not to accept that offer of unity.
Well, yes, it is. I mean, again, maybe if they'd had time to get used to the idea, it would have been a bit better. I mean, you know, people say, was that the SNP's reaction to ALAPA or Nicola Sturgeon's reaction to Alex Salmond or whatever? I suspect not. I mean, if you look at the SNP's reaction to, for example, the Independence of Scotland Party, which was launched a couple of years back, it was every bit as vehement, albeit on a smaller scale, than the reaction to ALAPA. But the kind of dog in the manger attitude that, you know, did cost us the possibility of having a substantial independence majority in the Scottish Parliament, and there are Labour and Tory MSPs who go to bed at night saying their prayers and thanking the divine intervention for the SNP reaction, because the opportunity was there to exploit the system. And the system is as it is. You play the system as you're given it. You know, as we all know, the two vote system for the Scottish Parliament was invented by the Labour Party to prevent the SNP ever getting a majority. So you're perfectly entitled to maximise the benefits from any political system for the cause. And of course, the aforesaid unionist MSPs are only there because of the list system, and not in the main because of constituency elections. So there's nothing wrong with playing the system to the best advantage for the political cause you're operating. That's what everybody does. That's what's called democracy or an electoral contest. But to fail to do it and to prefer effectively unionist MSPs in the Scottish Parliament to other independent supporting MSPs is quite a remarkable display of political rivalry, which is ill befits any independent supporting party, because you're entitled, obviously, to put forward a different point of view, different priorities, different policies. But at the end of the day, any independent supporter in the context of Scottish politics, it should prefer another independent supporter to a unionist. I mean, it is the essential divide in Scottish politics. The Scottish population know that. The political parties should know it as well.
Yeah, but you know, some of the people, the critics say, oh, well, that's all right. But Alex Salmond, he was shouting for two votes back in 2011 when he got his majority. But to you coin your phrase about your dad's phrase about you play the ball where it lies, the circumstances were completely different in 2011 because Labour were still, they were neck and neck with the SNP at that time. And so the circumstances for 1-2 was completely different.
Well, that's correct. And there wasn't another political party. I mean, if you like, the SNP didn't formally, even in the elections, say, you know, vote green in the list to get an independence majority. But there wasn't back in 2011. And obviously in 2011, we managed to get an overall majority. We saw the list and had our own message for the list. In other words, that we argued that the constituency section was to elect your constituency representative. The list was to be used to choose the next first minister. Mm. And we explicitly argued that position, and we got the overall majority. We effectively bust the system, which had been rigged against us. Mm. But in the context of having the independence question as the dominating issue of the day, and in the knowledge that it would be of great importance to that independence question to have a solid commanding majority in the Scots Parliament to advance that cause, so there could be no gainsaying the cause, then it was a remarkable dog in a manger attitude that the SNP adopted. Of course, one of the things in politics is to be proven right by events. The Alapa case was proven right by events, that an independent supermajority would have been worth having. It also raises the suspicion that there are some people, at least, who are not as enthusiastic about the idea of having an independent majority as I would be, and others in Alapa would be. But, you know, that's what happened then. We look to the future and see what the political opportunities are for the future.
Because, I mean, you're a man who knows the odds, et cetera, can work out the odds. What odds would you get in that ever happening again? I mean, what odds would you have gotten it happening in 2011? I mean, the likelihood of a majority under the de Hondt system is infinitesimal. Am I right? I mean, the odds would be huge.
Well, you have to get a full transfer of your vote. Yeah. You have to start with a commanding vote. You have to start with the other votes being divided. And I mean, what has also happened, and since 2011, while the SNP hum and haw about or are deeply opposed to giving Alapa the votes on the list, the Unionist parties, as is evident from the constituency section in particular, is their supporters have no such misgivings. Mm-hmm. I mean, the only reason there aren't any Liberal Democrats at all in the Scots Parliament, or at least the majority of Liberal Democrats are there, is because they get in on the votes of Labour and Tory supporters. Mm-hmm. Similarly, there are clear evidence of Unionist tactical voting in order to keep the SNP out. And that hasn't been very successful because the Unionist base of vote and people prepared to do that are very small, but it's perfectly clear from individual constituencies it goes on. I mean, Iain Murray, for example, if we take Westminster for a second, is a member of Parliament because of Unionists and particularly Tory tactical voting for him and his Edinburgh constituency to stop the SNP winning that seat. Yep. So, in a situation where you're dealing with a sophisticated electorate, and if you want to advance the cause of Scottish independence and you want to have a secure parliamentary majority for it, it seems daft not to recognise and use the electoral system democratically to maximum advantage.
Correct. So obviously we were all disappointed in that. But moving on, I mean, some people and parties might have sort of been broken by that. But actually, Alapa went from strength to strength. I mean, by the time September came around, we're having the first inaugural conference down there in Greenock. The membership's up well over that time, 5,000, nearly 6,000. All these things began to come together, office bearers, etc. That must have been a source of great joy for you to see that happening.
Yes, because the task there after the elections and the test was, would the party just fold and pack its tents and go away, or it would transform itself into a viable democratic political party with a grassroots organisation across Scotland and a membership to match. I mean, 6,000 members doesn't seem very much in contrast to the SNP's claimed membership, but it's very significant in contrast to the other parties. It's more the Liberal Democrats. It's on a par with the Tories and the Greens, probably surpassing both, actually. So it's a substantial membership. Actually, I remember very well, 6,000 members are important because when I came back as the SNP leader in 2004, we welcomed our 6,000th member, as I remember it, at the party conference. Mm. The SNP had 6,000 members back in 2004 as it challenged for supremacy in Scottish politics. Mm. So 6,000 members across the country, but obviously we'd like to have 10,000, we'd like to have more than 10,000. But that is a viable number, and a very, very high percentage of the Alapa membership are, of course, activists. activists with experience, and that will stand us in good stead when it comes to elections.
Yep.
And yes, the party was invigorated by the conference. I mean, many people said, you know, you can't have a conference, you've got to think of the conditions. But luckily, we were in a window where it was safe to do so. Mm-hmm. And we managed to have a, you know, a very invigorating conference, a policy platform, elections for our office bearers and our national executive, and taking it forward from there. You know, go back to this point about launching a political party ain't easy, but we've done it. Launching it during a pandemic isn't easy, but we've done it. And as soon as the situation allows, then I think Alapa will be extremely well placed in terms of grassroots campaigning to make its mark and to find its meter in the elections to come.
Yeah, I'd like to tell a small anecdotal story to that, because that, of course, it's no secret to anyone that watches this show that I'm an Alapa member and on the NEC. But just for people who don't know, I actually owe you an apology. Because I was in Dubai at the time. I decided to go to Dubai because my family said, oh, no, there's too much COVID, Dad. Come on out here. And so, and of course, as you know, I took ill. But I took pneumonia, but I didn't know at that time I had pneumonia. And the phone goes, and it was someone congratulating me on being on the NEC. And I said, oh, thanks very much. I went, who is this? He says, Alex. I went, Alex who? And of course, it was your good self. And I felt so mortified that I didn't know and didn't recognise your voice at the time. But I plead that I was obviously not very well at the time. And I'd just woken up out of sleep.
I wasn't aware that you weren't well.
Not was I at the time. I just felt rough. But it was 2 days later, I was in hospital. So I apologise to you for not recognising who it was. And I was very flattered. But there's more than that. Going on to November now. I want to go into next year more than anything. But the National Assembly, the first National Assembly we had was magnificent. And the National Council, which was later in Dunfermline, both in November. Again, these must have been a source of great pride to you to see the quality and how well these things were carried out and carried through.
Yeah, I mean National Assembly, but obviously many people in Alapa, but not all, but many people come from SNP roots. Mm-hmm. And we come from roots where we saw the SNP functioning at its best as a political party preparing to challenge the establishment of Scottish politics. And one of the SNP's great strengths was an institution called the National Assembly, which, for the benefit of the viewers, is a talking shop, because talking is important in politics. It's a discussion forum, mm-hmm. which doesn't hard set policy, but allows ideas to be explored on topical subjects. Mm-hmm. And I remember back as a young politician cutting my teeth at SNP National Assemblies and finding the conversation and discussion invigorating. And of course, it was much free and easier because you're not actually setting hard policy, you're mm-hmm. doing the preparation ground. Mm-hmm. An effort to have an online National Assembly of 140, I think it was, people discussing the questions of Scottish economy, Scottish currency, with a brilliant panel of economists. And doing it with people agreeing necessarily, but disagreeing in an intelligent and often humorous way was a very invigorating experience. You know, many arguments I was familiar with, but people would be tuning into that maybe for the first time, engaging in a political discussion. You know, if all political discussions were like that, lots more people would like to be in politics. Okay. And of course, out of that, and this is the whole point about National Assembly, came the motion on currency, which went to the National Council, which is a policy-making body.
Yeah.
And it's almost a perfect example of the best of political policy formulation. In other words, you have a preparatory discussion, no hard and certain policies, where ideas are explored. And out of that discussion, there comes distilled a motion to go to a policy-making body. Mm-hmm. And you know that if Alapa can do that in all of its policies. Now, I mean, I said earlier, I thought there was key planks of the independence programme that have to be revisited and reinvigorated. One of these is currency, one is Europe, one is borders. And if Alapa can apply the same intelligence to debating these other matters as it has done to the currency issue, then we can make a substantial contribution to Scottish political discourse.
Yep. We also had a National Day of Action, which again was really And it's something to be very appreciative of. You know, it was really well done. And throughout the country, there was people out on the streets with leaflets spreading the word of ALBA, because the most important thing is for the brand, the ALBA brand, to get out there. And the members certainly took that message out onto the streets in November as well.
Well, that's right. And I, again, realistically, we're people interested in politics. People watching this are probably interested in politics. Most political people, know who ALBA is. If I had to estimate, I would say that, there's 95% of the Scottish population in still have to learn what ALBA's got to offer. Now, you can only do that a number of ways. One of them is street campaigning. And, in normal times, ALBA would be incredibly active in street campaigning. It's because the ALBA activist base knows how to do it. It's something they understand. It hasn't been possible to do that. And it was good that in November and early December as well, we had the opportunity of a couple of days of action just to, maybe to plant some of the seeds for hopefully what we'll be able to do in a much larger scale in the spring. It's a bit like a new political machine, a new machine coming into operation. And what we're doing is doing a few trial runs here and there, making sure that the things are working in full working order in the right place and doing the preparatory work necessary so for it to be properly engaged in a full-scale operation, which is hopefully what the spring will allow us to do.
Because there's more and more LACUs and branches opening all the time, more and more members being added all the time. So we are growing, and to coin that phrase without sounding, ALBA is rising. And I've got to make special mention, because I'm sure you do, and you don't, it's like a football manager at the end of the game doesn't want to name his favourites or say particular players playing well, but we have to say that Kenny and Neil down at Westminster have been doing a tremendous job. I mean, they've certainly not only been holding the government to account, but they're showing that there's other Scottish MPs, shall we say, down there, who are not really promoting and working as hard as these two. They have been absolutely outstanding in their efforts down there.
Well, you couldn't get better colleagues than Kenny or Neil. And like the office bearers in ALBA as well. I mean, led by Tasmina's chair and the range of office bearers being elected, they're all proving their mettle. And some people like Kenny, Neil or Tasmina, or Chris McElhenney as the Secretary General, are pretty experienced in politics, and others have less experience, but they're all showing their mettle, and I couldn't have a better group of colleagues to take us forward. So, but Kenny and Neil, I've been in a Westminster Parliament where I was in a group of three, I know what it's like, to be in that environment with every person's hand turned against you. And to make an impression, to make a noise in that parliament, with that number of MPs, is a great achievement by Kenny and Neil. And the subjects they picked for debate, I'm particularly impressed by. Both Neil and Kenny have commanded adjournment debates. They're picking key subjects that matter to people. They're showing how you should use a parliament in terms of getting the best. I mean, the point about Westminster is that it's a platform, and you use it as a platform to advertise the ideas, and particularly to promote the cause of Scottish independence. It is, and I don't want to be, I mean, ALBA has to justify itself on its own merits. ALBA is not the anti-SNP party. ALBA is a Scottish independence party with a contribution to make. But, Westminster's an insidious place, and it is an incredibly easy place for people to settle down. And the fact that it's pretty clear that Kenny and Neil are two MPs who want to settle up for Scotland as opposed to settle down on the big benches, it's a big asset for them.
Yeah, it's very much. And so we're moving on. We're coming up. The next big task for us is, of course, the council elections in May. And I know the candidates have been selected. But just before I get to that, can I say, looking back now, hindsight, of course, is the greatest science of all, Alec. Is there anything, and I go back, I want to say, I think we've done great, but is there anything you would do different in the setting up of this, or anything that ALBA has done up to now that you would say, well, maybe I should have done this or that or not? Anything?
Well, it started earlier, absolutely. In terms of the Scottish elections, started earlier to get the message across and greater preparation. But as we discussed before, you play the balls at least. Apart from that, I think Arthur's on the right course. People wonder, what is Arthur for? And that the main thing for us to get across is the contribution we can make to the independence movement. In terms of political contributions, a bit like, I'm fond of making the analogy between the ALEPA and the SNP, with the SNP and the Labour Party in the 1990s. I led the SNP in the 1990s, with the three and four MPs that we had at the time. Then I knew it was going to be a while before the SNP could replace the Labour Party as the dominant party in Scottish politics, but also knew that every time the SNP had a success, that the Labour Party would recommit itself to the cause of the Scottish Parliament. And of course, that's exactly what happened. So I realised that we had a dual role at that time in the SNP of being both a party aspiring to be the government of Scotland one day, taking Scotland to independence, but also to be a group whose votes would and pressure would exert a favourable change in the Scottish political system. Well, ALEPA is in that position with the SNP at the present moment. Yes, obviously we have a viable political party. We have a clear objective of Scottish independence. We want to move things forward to Scottish independence. We see independence as our immediate priority for our country. But also we recognise that any ALEPA breakthrough in the local elections, for example, it will concentrate the SNP minds wonderfully, just as SNP breakthroughs used to concentrate the Labour Party minds wonderfully, and would get more energy, enthusiasm and commitment to Scottish independence from the Scottish government than we've had for a substantial number of years. So ALEPA has an honourable role as the grit and the oyster of the independence debate and its long-term ambition to be part of the firmament of the politics of an independent Scotland. And so therefore you see it's your political role and the contribution you've got to make, and that should dictate how you make that contribution. That's why I'm very, very keen on ALEPA, putting forward our views in a positive way, like the platform, like the National Assembly you mentioned, to get the right policy on the Scottish currency, like filling in the blanks and the rest of the independence argument. Obviously... Our main preoccupation at the present moment is making sure that there is an independence test, whether it be a referendum or any other democratic test, to get us to independence. A bit of preparation in terms of the project being put to the people would be a good thing as well. And so that's a good contribution ALEPA can make. But if we can make a breakthrough in these local elections, then it would inject some immediate enthusiasm into the timescale for getting to that independence test.
Yeah, I mean, the actual reality, unlike with Labour and SNP, between ourselves and the SNP, there's more that unites us than divides us. And I mean, on this show, I've got to say, I mean, in the recent weeks, I've had on the Douglas Chapman MP, I've had Angus Brendan McNeil on, Graham McDonald, that's terrible, if I get his name wrong, I'll be getting into trouble, I like to think of us as the fundamental wing of the old SNP who are now in the ALEPA party, but we are similar. So it's not quite as Labour and SNP. We are brothers in arms, really.
Brothers and sisters in arms. But it may be that Douglas Chapman and Angus Brennan McNeil are maybe closer to ALEPA than they are to some of the colleagues, at least in the SNP. But I think it's, like, we've got a legitimate argument with the SNP, and that's that people in ALEPA feel, I think rightly, and I think the evidence is overwhelming, that there's insufficient enthusiasm in terms of the timescale of getting to independence and insufficient ability to take advantage of the manifest political opportunities that Scotland has had in recent years. So that's our main... That's our main distinctive selling point as a political party. We're the party who believes in the immediate advancement of the independence cause as an immediate priority. Something for the here and now, not for the hereafter. That's the ALEPA case. We have other disagreements with the SNP. The question on sex-based rights, protected space for women would be an example of that. But our predominant argument, discussion, disagreement with the SNP is we think the independence case should be a much, much more obvious priority in terms of timescale. Okay. And we think more energy and enthusiasm should be going into making that happen. And we suspect that some people, not Douglas Chapman, not Angus McNeil, maybe overcomfortable with being part of the firmament at Westminster or in Scotland of a devolved Scotland, forgetting that the SNP were not formed to be the government of a devolved Scotland. They were formed to be the instrument of taking Scotland to independence. And if ALAPA can inject that reminder into the Scottish body politics, then we'll have done a great service, not just to ourselves, but to our country.
Could on that subject, where we're facing from, I'd like to go back to, if you imagine this is the Christmas of 2012-2013 time, we're a year away from our referendum. How far along the line were you with the draft referendum bill, with the 500-page white book? How far along were you with that by the time 2013 came along?
Well, I remember at the time thinking I'd like to have been further advanced, incidentally, in some of the preparations. But the preparations were fine. I mean, the white paper, if you remember, was launched in, I think, late November 2013. So it was launched sometime before if you all had time again, I think the white paper, if anything, was probably too detailed. Mm-hmm. It strayed too far in trying to be light, because we thought that was our duty. I think we probably strayed into too much policy detail. In other words, the sort of things that would have been the proper things to be contested at the first elections to an independent Scotland and choices to be made, as opposed to material in the referendum campaign. It's a balance that has to be struck, of course. I mean, on the one hand, you don't want to paint a slogan on a bus like the Brexiteers and call it a white paper manifesto. On the other hand, you know, perhaps we went into the stroking every T as we could, and so that would be certainly something that I would advise the next group of people planning that to have a think about. Yep. And also the second issue, I think we saw the campaign at that stage, maybe a year before the referendum, in terms of the unity between political parties. You know, I was very anxious to make sure the Greens were on board, that the smaller independent supporting parties, you know, Solidarity, etc., were on board and were consulted. And perhaps I should have been concentrating a bit more in a grassroots movement of cross-party, but thinking a bit more of non-party. Mm-hmm. And lastly, I would think the lesson of the referendum, and it's a lesson for now, incidentally, that we have to recognise that the real disenfranchisement in Scotland is the people who are not in the electoral roll. And, you know, luckily, because of the enthusiasm injected into the debate in the summer of 2014, there's probably a greater expansion, you know, in America, because of the discrimination against black people. For years they've had red because of the states, particularly the southern states, which have deliberately kept people off the electoral roll. Now that has been more important in many cases than the actual election itself has been, the registration of electors. And there was a bit of that in Scotland in 2014. We had a huge effort to get people onto the roll, and perhaps starting that a bit early. I mean, these things are always difficult because you don't get into the intense excitement of the summer of 2014 before the imminence of the referendum. You can't create that excitement in 2013 because the referendum was September 2014. Mm-hmm. Timescale to things. But perhaps more awareness of the extent and possibilities of the grassroots movement and more awareness of the importance of getting people onto the franchise would have been a couple of things as well. But, listen, obviously the strategy of 2014 is different from the strategy of 2022. or 23 or 24 or 25 or 26 of the SNP is having to do with it, or 2033 or whatever. Why? Because the world has changed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we started a campaign with the Edinburgh Agreement in 2012. We're independence. I mean, you can argue about which poll, but that would be roughly accurate. And the way you deploy a campaign with independence at 30% is totally different than the way you deploy it at 50%. You know, 30%, I believe that we have to narrow the areas of argument. If you remember my themes of, well, listen, there's lots of unions and the only one we want to change is the political union.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's the social union between Scotland and England, which I hope we'd still argue for, of course. But there's the European Union. Well, you know, we're in a different situation. There's a, you know, defence union. There's a monarchical union.
Mm-hmm.
Trying to say, like, there's these things which remain the same, and the only area of difference is the political union to enable us to make different political choices.
Mm-hmm.
That was a strategy for starting at 30% of the vote.
Mm-hmm.
If you start from a heavy minority position, you know, it's best to try and get your progress on key areas for discussion. How you conduct an argument to win a majority from 30% and how you conduct one from 50%, entirely different. Entirely different. And I don't think there's been, you know, it's a different world. Politics has changed, the world has changed, the economy has changed, circumstances have changed, Scotland has changed, and the independence campaign has to change with it.
Mm-hmm.
So some things you would do differently, some lessons you would learn, some things you would do the same, because after all, if we started at 30%, ended up at 45%, we didn't win. But, you know,
we didn't do too bad.
we made some degree of progress. There's lots of stuff in that you'd want to replicate and do again.
Mm-hmm.
But you have to catch up in the modern world.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, in this new world, which not all of which we wished for, mm-hmm. We are no longer in the European Union. The economics of countries and currencies are entirely different in terms of how you look for economic and fiscal, in particular, freedom. We've moved into a different age, an age that we largely anticipated back, but in terms of the, you know, energy and the configuration of Scotland, the industrial configuration of Scotland, the markets available to Scotland, how to make Scotland successful and how to make it fair and just. These are all things that have changed, and therefore the areas you want to accentuate, policies you want to develop, the platform you need to furnish and burnish are entirely different. And I think if Halapa continues to make a contribution to that, thinking about the independence campaign, that in itself will be extremely valuable.
I totally agree. We're coming to the end of our time. I just ask you one last question, if I may.
Sure.
I've got another dozen that I probably could. I can maybe ask you them later. Is that Kenny's written, I have as well, written about some kind of constitutional convention to kickstart the independence campaigning again, because we've been inert since 2014. We haven't done any independence campaigning. What do you think about the possibility of some kind of, you know, constitutional independence convention? Would that get your blessing? Not necessarily led by Alapa, I'm just saying your blessing. Would that be something that you would...
Well, yeah, convention by definition has to be elected people. In fact, I mean, what I find exciting about the framework of the local government platform that Lee Wilson, as a local government convener, put together, is it embraces the convention idea by saying, look, well, firstly, when you stand a local election, every candidate will put forward the local issues for the local ward. That's a predominant thing for every single candidate. But there's three things that all our candidates will be putting forward. The five-point plan against family and child poverty, which is extremely important and has great proposals in it. The core question of women's rights, the protection of safe spaces for women in terms of the health service and changing rooms and toilet facilities and other matters. I mean, these are real important issues in Scotland this time. But the constitutional element we inject into the debate is every ALAPA elected councillor will want to take part in an independence convention, which should be for elected members, people given a mandate by the Scottish. Inject the urgency for that convention idea through a local election campaign, it strikes me as something which is particularly important and will be one of the three key points in the ALAPA platform. So yeah, of course, how do you kickstart that campaign given that the Parliament, as up to now, hasn't been prepared to lead it? Well, you embrace the idea of the convention, all people are elected and who are prepared to support independence, which will coordinate the grassroots and mobilisation that's going to be required to make the opportunity for self-determination happen.
Mm-hmm. How about Civic Scotland? Would you want them to participate?
Well, I mean, I was a great friend with Canon Kenyon Wright, the late Canon Kenyon Wright. And in circumstances which, in many senses, is much more difficult than they are now, I thought him bringing forward the convention, the constitutional convention back in the 1990s was a bit of a masterstroke. Now, the failings of that convention, and I was deliberately excluding the independence argument, you know, what wasn't kind of Kenya Wright's choice. he actually founded it on a, which of course we could all sign up to, or should all be able to sign up to. Even Donald, you're signed up to it, that the Scots people could choose the government best suited to their needs through self-determination. But obviously it became a matter of excluding the independence argument about devolution. But the techniques employed in terms of embracing Civic Scotland, local government, other institutions, the normalisation of the self-government argument that was employed in that convention was extremely good. Now, much, much further down the road, there is an independence majority in the Scots Parliament, even if it's not a supermajority. Independence is the key dividing line in Scottish politics. 50% of the population believe in it, 50% don't. But we should be at the point of decision. So a lot of an independence convention, as I would see it, it would be to say, like, how do we secure mm-hmm. that right, that demand for self-determination? What do we need to do in terms of Civic Scotland, grassroots Scotland, the organisation of demonstrations, the international diplomatic lobbying, the legal preparations that are going to be required to state the case for legitimacy of Scotland's case, mm-hmm. and the recognition that The route I chose back in 2011, 2012 was the route designed for the times. That was to enable Scotland to have the choice. Mm. The idea that's the only way, or even the best way, is to put the cart before the horse. Because just as traditionally the SNP shouldn't run a devolved Scotland, it's not the Scottish referendum party. The job of parties in a convention, an independence convention, is to be independence parties. How do you get to independence? What? How do you secure a referendum? How do you secure this? How do you secure the means of a democratic test to enable the people of Scotland to vote for independence? Not a Section 30 or as the only true route, but something that secures the legitimacy of the independence case and therefore its recognition. That is the task. It's a great task, and it's one that we should employ the people of all parties and those of none, of Civic Scotland, of people of goodwill and the energy and commitment to take Scotland's case forward. That's the sort of independence convention you want to see. And the more ALAPA votes that are in the local elections, the more likely that is to come into being this year.
As I definitely say, we're just about to go, but I just wanted to ask you, one of my fellow bloggers sent this one, and it's, what advice would you give to bloggers and the new media that will help them to write truthfully but stay out of jail? Obviously, a reference to what happened to Craig. What can the bloggers do to protect themselves?
Well, what happened to Craig Murray was a total disgrace and a sustained blot on the Scottish legal system, Scottish justice, that shamed Scotland. In terms of my advice to bloggers, in terms of contributing the case for independence, it's a bit like, I rather like to, you know, Andrew Marr's sign off from his program, you know, keep it classy, Santiago from the famous Anchorman film of some years ago. My advice to bloggers would be keep it classy, but keep it positive. social media's most enormous advantage to the independence case, because it's not controlled by the unionist establishment the same way that other means of media still are. But if we want to win this, we've got to keep it positive. I don't mean not have a bit of, you know, jocular leg pulling and inspirational fun and the rest of it. But Craig actually is a good example of that. I mean, Craig, for the most part, in his highly successful blog, he brings forward incredibly intelligent arguments that people want to read. And so I would, my message to bloggers in terms of contributing to independence cases to use the phrase, but keep it positive. Keep it positive, Scotland.
We will indeed. Alec, can I thank you? We've overrun a wee bit, but how often do I get a chance to talk to your good self? Thank you for your time at this time of the year, making time available. And have you any big plans for the new year, or is it quiet night at home?
No, do I do it in the holiday period is nothing. As little as possible. This is my my recipe for the Christmas New Year holidays is do as little as possible. Because the rest of the, and the recipe for the rest of the year is do as much as possible.
Yeah.
But for this period, do as little as possible. Lock the doors, do as little as possible.
Well, I've given up. And
obviously, drink in moderation.
Behave yourself. No, I have trouble convincing my neighbours to have a good old Scottish New Year, but anyway. Have a good new year, and I will see you hopefully very, very soon. Again, much, much thanks for your time and effort tonight. Thank you, Alec.
And a good new year to all your viewers.
Thank you and very much. Bye.
Well, big thank you to Alex Salmond there. And now to help me talk about what's going on this year and my chat there with Alec, I'm joined by my two compadres, the Paisley Mohawk, and the Coatbridge Cavalier, Iain Lawson, and, of course, Phil Boswell of the SNP. Gentlemen, how are we today? You have a nice Christmas?
Lovely Christmas once it gets started. I actually had my Christmas on the Monday rather than the Saturday because my granddaughter was unwell, but it was very enjoyable when it arrived.
Good. How about you, Phil? Anything exciting?
Aye, magic. That was great. Come back to India, back in Scotland. A wee bit colder than I remember, but it's apparently mild. But there you go. My blood's must have thinned all that time in India.
Well, there we had it. Well, I thought it was appropriate for us in the year-end show to have Alec on. I was the first person that gave us our first video Prism show. So, and it's the leader of the Alba Party, and by many was recognised as the top independence man, political independence man. I thought it was appropriate. He was his usual very slick self, Iain, always the consummate politician.
Yes, well, I mean, Alec is the consummate politician. I don't think he said anything that surprised any of us. It was very much an interview where he was laying out broad strokes rather than incisive planning. And I think that's probably what you expect. He's not going to reveal his opponents any plans that he may have, particularly immediate plans in the next few months. But I think Alba do need to get their act together, and they do need to, you know, start moving away from, you know, the internal organisation, which, to their credit, they've handled brilliantly and got in place. But they need to have a more outward-looking phase between now and the local elections if they're to have any impact in those elections.
And Phil, you worked closely with Alec as well. I mean, you were in Parliament with him. Did you enjoy what he had to say tonight?
Well, I know Alec in so much as that he will not. He will not. He plays his cards close to his chest. He's the consummate politician. He really is the best and probably the only genuine genius politician we've had in Scotland in the last 50 years or beyond, and he really is the father of the movement as it stands at the moment, and it's lost its impetus. The last thing Alex is going to do is, if he's got a cunning plan, as he always had several, there was always a plan B with Alex. See when you're working on something with him, there's a given scenario, It's like a probability analysis. You would do a P90, a P53, a P10. What's the worst that can happen? What's the best that can happen? What are the options? And what do we do in any given scenario? The last thing you want to do is you're not going to tell everybody. I mean, it's like, if you're going to hit somebody, don't tell them you're going to hit them. Just hit them. You know, and I was like, and I don't mean that in a physical sense. I mean it politically and in any contest you're going to have. You don't give away. So I didn't see anything there that shocked me. But there was some of this. I think we talked about ALBA and SNP and ISP are now the political parties toward independence. Not just getting ALBA needs to get its act together and continue to push forward from a very good start, I think, under the circumstances. I know we talked about, I would have loved to have started it earlier, but you couldn't. The circumstances were such that was impossible, and it shouldn't have been necessary. That's the thing that gets me. SNP, more than anybody, needs to put its house in order, and we need to put our house in order so that we fight and push towards independence.
Iain, he is the absolute, as we've said, you know, the politician of the politician. But one thing that I'm not sure, you know, my great love of this idea of an independence constitutional convention to get things moving. Alex seems to think, from what I could gather, I don't know what you guys picked up, that he thinks that it should be led by politicians. I think the exact opposite. I think it should be a people-led thing. Did I pick it up wrong, or did you get that?
That's what Alec was saying. But I mean, I tend to agree more with you than I do with Alec in that. I think, you know, the politicians, let's be frank, have had their chance. And, you know, year after year passes with mandate after mandate and nothing happens, you know. So the argument for leaving it in politicians' hands is a very weak one in my view. And I think, you know, if for no other reason than getting some momentum, then I think you need to widen the base away from just politicians and bring in all the various yes groups, you know, Civic Scotland, everybody should have their say. And that may provide the impetus that forces the politicians to take some action. Because, you know, frankly, the way the SNP are at the moment, they're not going to do anything unless they're, you know, pressurised into doing it, and it'll be a last resort with them. I mean, I have absolutely no faith in the current SNP to deliver anything other than salaries for themselves. That's their priority. We need to get them out of that complacent situation, and I don't know how best to do that other than scaring them electorally, and I think that's why ALBA has a role. You know, and if the ALBA can get their act together, if they can win some council seats next May, then that would maybe be the impetus that, you know, ordinary members of the SNP would say, wait a minute, you know, we're in real danger here unless we start doing real things rather than the kid on politics, childish politics of the last 6 years.
I don't want to be cynical, Phil, especially you being an ex-MP, but, you know, I view all politicians as present companies, always excluded, as ambulance chasers. And, you know, that's why you see them with a food bank, they're standing there smiling, they don't get the optics of that. Yeah, and they're standing there, or if there's a disaster, they turn up, or if there's something that they go. So I believe also, because they're ambulance chasers, if it's led by the public and they say, oh, wait a minute, we better get on this bandwagon, because if we don't, we're going to get left behind. That's why I think it has to be, one of the reasons why it has to be led by the people. But Iain's right, yeah. I believe, too. The people have been ignored too much, and we've left it to the politicians. And it's time the people spoke up and took matters into their own hands. Don't you think so?
Well, the crux of the matter for me is something Iain said earlier. SNP are not affecting the will of the people at the minute, and that's my disappointment in my party. We have given six... we've given our party, SNP, for six mandates. And you look at the polls, I know we'll probably talk about that coming up. A seventh one, what difference is that going to make? Seven monkeys, another monkey on the back. If you're not going to affect it, what's the point? So there's a marriage here. you need the politicians to give effect to the will of the people. You're not going to get independence through a committee. It's chaotic. It's not going to happen. Anyone who runs organisations and understands organisations or management of people, you can have some great ideas, but there's always curveballs and there's always a radical element that want to push it too far. There's somebody wants to do too much, somebody wants to do too little, and there's got to be experienced decision makers who understand the machinations of public office and how it works to give effect to the will of the people. So for me, it's a marriage. So Alex, you're both right. Alex is right, and given his experience, you know, I think a national council, the convention, I think, you know, I'm looking more and more to a more assertive opinion on independence. And you look at what Sinn Féin are doing. 1905, they had a national convention, and that's when they found their principles in a national convention by the people, not the politicians, but was given effect by the politicians. And I'm now in a situation where I'm thinking, if our politicians aren't given effect to the will of the people, then they need to be reminded. And they're reminded that who put them there? What are you there for? What's your job? And I disagree that all politicians are ambulance chasers, because I know that I wasn't. I know that there are still MPs there who, after seven years, generalising. I think generally it's true, but after 7 years, if the penny hasn't dropped that you're having no effect, then when is the penny going to drop? Who's in control here? You've got to look to your leadership, and I this is why you've got to hold politicians to account. The leadership determine what the priorities are and how you give effect to the will of the people. And at the minute, SNP are failing us. Our current management are failing us. We are not independent. 2014, 2012, we were on the rise. And very, very soon, in just a matter of days, it's going to be 10 years later. And what? We've not moved forward one iota from 2014? Mm-hmm. Not good enough. That's not good enough. That's got to change. How we change it, it's another matter. And that's why we need people like Alex.
Iain, I would contest that, you know, Phil's right, in 2012, 13, the rise came. But that came, in my opinion, because the Yes movement, not led by politicians, but led by the people from the grassroots upwards, actually bought in and ignited it. And the politicians were, you know, quickly to jumping onto the Yes, and they were coming to the Yes, organised meetings and town halls and rallies and marches. That's when the politicians arrived. That's what I think needs to happen again.
Well, I mean, I've been involved in politics since the 1970s. And I've contested elections and been involved in everything. I've never seen anything like I saw in 2014 in the referendum. I had contested elections in areas like Dunchapel, for instance, you know, the big schemes. And of course, the problem any politician had in those days in these big schemes was that people just tended to rather lazily vote Labour, or they were completely apathetic and disinterested. And I've got to say, in all honesty, you know, in 2014, I was going into these very same schemes that had been full of apathy, and people were genuinely engaged. That was the exciting thing. People wanted to know about that referendum campaign more. They wanted to be part of it. And that was the excitement that was generated at that time. And it became, you know, self-motivating, because, you know, one of the lessons of politics, I'd seen it in Govan with Jim Sillars in 1988, once you get these schemes moving, they move very, very quickly. And, you know, Jim, as you know, overturned a huge, huge Labour majority in Govan because he got these schemes moving, and then he followed through. It was the exact same thing in 2014. We did not lose in 2014 because of these giant housing schemes. They were converted to Yes. I've got absolutely no doubt, having been in many of them all over the country, that they voted a majority Yes. It was other areas, people with other priorities, that let Scotland down at that time. So, you know, it can be done. But it takes more than just the politicians themselves. It takes the people to get excited, to get motivated, to get joined in. And when that happens, anything's possible. But we need to find a mechanism to do that again, because the last 6 years...
She has to appear on the last show.
Apologies, everyone.
They never let us down.
Ian's looking a wee bit
agitated.
I'm a bit agitated. This doesn't happen in the BBC or STV studios. No, you weren't.
Yeah, well, we should be agitated. We should be agitated.
But on the point of what Ian's saying there, and you know, talking about these opinion polls that come out just now, the politicians, SNP politicians, were all getting very excited that it shows that there was two different polls, but certainly they're all favourable for the SNP. One showing that they would gain a couple of seats to 48, another one saying they would win all the seats, another one saying that Labour would get 10 seats, but in all of them, the Tories were getting wiped out, and they were getting very excited, Phil. And I can understand that, but here's the problem I have with that. We have been assured by the Nicola Sturgeon and Mike Russell and others in the SNP that with or without a Section 30, there will be an independence referendum in 2023, one whole year before the United Kingdom general election. So the question I want answered is, why are you so young? Look, we can replace the Tories, we can get rid of the Tories at the UK general election. When does this mean that they're going to run the referendum in anticipation of losing it? Or are they lying to us that there's not going to be a referendum? It's got to be one or the other. Why else would you celebrate what's going to happen the year after you're meant to be independent?
It doesn't add up. Huge. I've lost my faith in Nicola. I've lost my faith in Nicola. So when somebody like Mike Russell gets involved, though, the admiration I have for that man and what he's achieved in his lifetime in politics. I don't want to say too much, but I'm going to say a very strong word: betrayal. In human terms, you know, whether it be a relationship or a work scenario, if you're betrayed, it's an extremely difficult place to come back from. Extremely difficult place to come back from. And when we, the people, have given our party, my party, and what was your party, the SNP, six mandates, the seven monkeys I talked about earlier. What difference is a seventh monkey if you're not going to do anything about it? It's another monkey in the back of the people. And for what? What's going to be achieved? And the fact that we're being told that 2023 is... I mean, I saw the debate between Nicola and a good friend of mine, I still have a guy I've got time for, Iain Blackford, and they were having a conversation. It was like ham acting. I've got to call it as I see it. It's like, oh, yeah, but the conditions got to be right in 23. Yeah, we're going to do it in 23. Of course we're going to, but the conditions have got to be just perfect. Nonsense. It's ham acting, and you could see right through it, and that disappoints me, to play people that way. That's approaching, and I'm not going to say it's betrayal, because I believe they both want independence. But the fear I have is they want something else more. That's my fear.
Ian, what's your take on SNP politicians being excited about a general election a year after we're meant to be independent?
It does prove one thing quite significantly. I mean, it shows there's no strategy. There's no belief even in what Nicola's saying amongst those who are enjoying the seat of power and the salaries that go with it. You know, I mean, in any world, it's a complete and utter joke that they should be getting excited about an election that, if they're actually going to deliver what they're promising today, they wouldn't be eligible to stand in the election because we'd be independent in a way. I mean, it just shows you how completely disjointed the thinking is within the SNP. You know, how an MP can, you know, publicly get excited about a poll that's a poll for an election that's happening after your independence referendum. You know, beggars belief. It's quite unbelievable, but it happened, and it was widespread as well. It wasn't one individual, it was them all.
Well, no, this came down from on high. You know, let's promote this. And I've got to say, I politely, because I didn't get blocked by either, asked Mike Russell and I asked Angus Robertson, could they square this circle for me? Because I couldn't understand why they were talking about that. And needless to say, I've had no reply from either. And as yet, at the moment, not blocked. But, you know, there's time. There's time. But meanwhile, across this year, if we were having this last year, and I said to you, here we are a year later, guys, what progress has been made for independence in the last 12 months? I mean, we've had an election, we've had a few new political parties, but how much further forward are we, on the 1st of January 2022 than we were in 2021?
Watch the words. The wording has changed slightly. There has been more talk of independence from the SNP leadership, but no firm and hard promises. That's what I find most disconcerting. It's almost as if some new party has forced the hand where SNP, we have now got to be seen to be more proactive in terms of independence without actually doing anything about it, because there's nothing firm. There is nothing firmer, no further forward is the answer to that question. I mean, the poll, the Tories are down, they're out, Labour will come bouncing back to a degree, and I think the SNP is about the same, is it? It's but overall, they take some of the Tory seats, which is great, which is always welcome. An independence party and my party SNP winning seats, I'm all for, but at what cost? If it's to the cost of the whole initiative of the drive of the independence movement, then it's not progress, it's jobs worth, and that's just not acceptable. I mean, you look at what the Irish have done, and you've now got Sinn Féin, a very assertive, once could have been described as aggressive party, who were champions of a united Ireland, of abstentionism, of some of the more radical philosophies, republicanism, the stuff that we get quite nervous about, and I certainly was when I get involved in politics initially. And they're now on the cusp of forming the next government of Ireland. They're taken seriously by the Americans. They're taken seriously by the Europeans. And you hear people like Mary Lou McDonald, and you hear, I mean, I had the privilege of, once when we were in Westminster, I had a choice as a Coatbridge MP, the Dalai Lama was having holding a session with a number of MPs now invited to that, or Sinn Féin. I thought, well, come if you Coatbridge, I'm going to Sinn Féin, you know, because this is what, there's a closer tie towards republicanism. There's abstentionism to talk about, to think about, and how these people have stuck to their guns, excuse the pun, because that's what they want to avoid. That, thankfully, they've avoided that. They've come away from that, and they've become now the accepted face of a strong will of the people of Ireland, and not just ERA, of the North as well. A unifying strength has come from it. When they renounce the gun, when a plumber puts down his tool bag and picks up a gun, you're in serious trouble. But when he puts back his gun down and picks up his tool bag and votes with the ballot, that's where the strength lies. That's where their strength lies, the courage of their convictions. What do we see? Where's our equivalent of that? Where's our assertiveness? Where's our confidence in ourselves? When are we going to stand up and be counted? When are we going to say that this is what the people want, this is what we're going to provide? And damn you, we're not interested in kowtowing to any to what Westminster wants and playing by your rules. No. We could take great lessons from Martin McGuinness. What I loved about the conversation, I had the privilege of a one-to-one for about 10, 15 minutes at that meeting. And he gave Reverend Ian Paisley huge credit. I was surprised. I didn't know what his game was. And said that Reverend Ian Paisley didn't get the respect he deserved for the Good Friday negotiations. Why? Because the distance he had to come to compromise from UVF and the radicals on the right and the union side, and what he did, I took it as the kind of middle path that is required in Scotland. We need to forgive and forget all this nonsense that's going on and unify behind the indie movement as we did in 2014 with leaders who are all facing the same direction and not interested in lining their own pockets. Otherwise, we're doomed.
Yeah, what the yawning gap in Scottish politics is, though, is the lack of vision and ambition. You know, and I mean that not just amongst the politicians, you know, for any independence movement to be successful, you need to create vision and ambition in the people. And we've grossly failed in that. People don't have this vision of an independent Scotland. I think perhaps back in 2014, it was beginning to happen, and I think that's why we made the rapid progress that we did. But it's been put to sleep, frankly, in the last 6 or 7 years. And we need to re-engage that, because once people have the vision, once people have the ambition, the support follows. But without it, it's very, very difficult indeed. And that takes quality leadership. Now, yes. When you're talking about what's happening in Ireland with Sinn Féin, that is quality
leadership.
And that's the difference between their fight and ours.
Now, ours isn't so much. I mean, Phil talks about putting down the plumber's tools and picking up a gun. Our lot put down the plumber's tools and picked up a limp, wet
limp biscuit
off a tree. I mean,
tools and going for a tea break.
You know, one of the best tweets I've seen all week was the only way to guarantee to get the SNP to walk out of the chamber at Westminster is for an ALBA MP to stand up to speak.
Sadly true. Yeah. Sadly true.
That's the truth. That's the sad truth. And it goes back to I've been shouting for unity. A lot of us have been saying about unity, but I've got to say it takes two people to tango. And as you've highlighted with the Reverend Iain Paisley, the distance that he had to come to, you know, share a platform with Martin McGuinness was massive. And yet,
wonderful, beautiful thing.
As I said to Alec there earlier in the interview, between us and the SNP, there is more that unites us than divides us. It's personality at the top of one of these parties that is dividing the whole movement, the parties. They should be together. We should be already working on a pact for the forthcoming council elections, because STV, Vote to Your Vote, will be doing a special programme on that on next year. Is we should be uniting as one group under a Yes banner to make sure that we clear unionists out of the councils here. Surely that's the way forward.
Of course it is. Of course it is. But, I mean, I just don't see it under the current leadership. Nicola Sturgeon is a divisive figure with a capital D. She's not interested in any shape or form of allowing anyone else into her, what she regards as her power orbit. She wants it all for her. And, of course, it's completely negative. And, I mean, the real problem with that philosophy is that's fine when everything's going dandy. But when the rot sets in, as it's beginning to set in within the SNP, it rots from the head and the damage will be huge. And, I mean, she talks about not wanting to damage the movement. No one in my lifetime has damaged the independence cause more than Nicola Sturgeon's doing at the moment. People say, oh, well, we're doing well in the polls. You're doing well in the polls because of public ignorance. But the public ignorance is beginning to slip. The newspapers are starting to report some of the real problem areas. Whether they get their 9 million or not, it might postpone it a wee bit longer. But, I mean, I would just say this to independent supporters. When the leader of the SNP, effectively the leader of the Yes movement, has a shared agenda with the British media in Scotland, there's got to be something wrong there somewhere. And you only need to look at their treatment of Alex Salmond and Alba. The British media are absolutely petrified that Alba becomes a factor in Scottish elections. And they're effectively being blanked, far worse than Pravda or Taskin Manage. They're being censored out the competition. And that's for a reason, because their agenda, the British media's agenda, has been very well served by the leader of the SNP.
I
was going to put you in the spot anyway, Phil, so here's the simple thing. During the May election for Holyrood, Nicola Sturgeon said that she could work with British Labour and Anna Sarwar, but she couldn't work with Alex Salmond and the Independence ALBA party. She's done the same again when she was talking about the parties must unite and we can work with British Labour. She didn't mention ISP, she didn't mention ALBA. It kind of sends out a contradictory message, does it not?
It does, and it's why I was loath to mention the very strong word betrayal. But I mentioned it, and I'm not equating it right now, but I'm very close. I mean, Iain was talking about the ignorance of the electorate. Quite often we use the unaware situation. We use assertive. We want to be more assertive. We don't want to be aggressive. Language is important. Language is very, very important. And if you pay attention to the language, betrayal is a very strong word that I put out there. I'm putting out there just now because I look at the Scottish political discourse and something Alec touched on. Why is it that SNP MPs are talking about GRA hate crime in Section 30 and MSPs, whereas you've got Alaba MPs talking about Europe, borders and currency? Who's focused here? Who's focusing on the will of the people and what we want? Who's paying attention to the electorate? Now, the electorate may be unaware, but the electorate are unaware. People are too busy getting on with their lives. God forbid, you know, your family come first, your job, and God, you know, you might get a wee bit of relaxation time. You can go play a bit of golf or do something else. Nobody's interested in the accounts of a country or the manifesto promises that were broken, not broken, the 35 fiscal and monetary levers to run an economy. That's not on MD's Christmas list. You know, what people are talking about is we are aware of certain things. And people are beginning to dawn on people that SNP are taking the mick here. Where's the action? You're the party of promise. There's still a lot of good people in SNP. And a lot of young people have got involved in it, and a lot of people are coming new to this party and have the same vigour that we had when we were in 2012, 2014. But I'm putting betrayal out there because we're damn close to it. We're so close to it, and that is I can't forgive. If this comes to pass, as I fear it will, that you cannot forgive. And that's where the damage will come. That's where the damage will come.
Guys, as the years are running out, time is beating us as usual, and as I overran a wee bit with Alec. We've had a great year, guys. We've had a great year. What's been the highlights of these prisms for you, Iain?
I think the fact that they've become a regular feature, I mean, it's not easy to come up with interesting programmes week after week, but we've had some great guests.
As we prove.
Well, I mean, we've had some great programmes. We've had a lot of laughs as well in between, because I think, you know, in Scotland's situation, if you didn't have a sense of humour, you know, it would be really very depressing indeed. So I think what we try to do, certainly what I try to do, is I try to tell it as I see it, but I also try to give folk a bit of hope that things can get better, because that's what we all need to hear.
What about you, Phil? What have you enjoyed about it?
I think the continuity of that, the hope that we all had in that passion we all shared in the 2014 election, especially the ability to continue when you see some of the greats like Alex Salmond being huckled. I mean, that disgusts me. What happened to him? What's been done to him by our own people? That enrages me. The attacks on Wings Over Scotland, losing one of the greatest bloggers about, whether you agree with everything he says or doesn't say, we were on the same side. Who turned that against it? This is perfidious Albion at work. And to continue the fight and maintain a positive view. I mean, this what we continually do is bring a positive the case for independence. We continue that mantra. And to date, since 2012, we've all been asking, show us the positive case for the union, and it's failed. No one's delivered that to me. I've not heard it. So we need to keep focused. We need to make more people aware that within our own organisation, and I'm talking about SNP here, there are those who have lost their way, whether deliberately or otherwise, and they need to get back on track. And it's our responsibility as the members and as the people to get that message to them, make sure they understand it. Woe betide them if they don't.
Well, Can I just say my bit? I've thoroughly enjoyed this. It was, as I say, started with Alec being our first video broadcast, and it's gone and grown from there. And we have tried to keep it unity and promote unity by having SNP and ALBA and non-aligned people. And we will continue to do that. Others may try to keep the division going, but this programme will always shout for unity. And can I just thank everyone that's participated all year. You guys, especially, for helping me out every week. And of course, Techie, who is in the background making all the, moving all the knobs and buttons or whatever he does. Got a special thanks to him and to all our contributors. But most of all, to those of you who take the time to actually watch this show and give us your opinions. So to you and yours, a good new year. And to you and yours, and may it prove everything that you hope it will be. Until we speak to you again in the new year, please, please, take care. Bye, guys.
Happy New Year.
Slanja.
Should old acquaintance be forgot and never brought to mind? Should old acquaintance be forgot for Auld Lang Syne? For Auld Lang Syne, my jo, for Auld Lang Syne, wilt thou take a cup o' kindness yet for Auld Lang Syne? Surely you'll be your pine stoop, and surely I'll be mine, and we'll take a cup o' kindness yet for Auld Lang Syne. For Auld Lang Syne, my jo, for Carrega.